Bill, I'll let you start, and then we'll pray after we sing, okay?
I'll video it.
Yes, we say, God peace like a river, God peace like a river, God peace like a river in my soul. I've got peace like a river, I've got peace like a river.
Yeah, now that you got the kinks out, that's the first time I've sung all day. Yeah, let's say it again.
I've got peace like a river. I've got peace like a river. I've got peace like a river in my soul. I've got peace like a river. I've got peace like a river. I've got peace like a river in my soul.
I like rivers. I've always liked rivers. When I was growing up, I lived about 2 miles from a river, small river. In fact, they call it a creek. But it was a river. And I could ride there on my bicycle, and I'd go down there, and we did a lot of camping, we'd always try to find a river. It's hard, because everybody else wanted to be by the river, too, see. But anyway, rivers were peaceful. If they're not flooded, rivers are peaceful. And the scripture refers to rivers several times, and likens rivers to peace, which I think is interesting. And Isaiah writes in Isaiah 48:18, oh, that you had heeded my commandments, then your peace would have been like a river. So a hymn writer writes that even that it's glorious. You know what hymn that is? Like a river. Let's sing it. 208. And its broad increase all together. Perfect in a flow of fuller. And we always take a breath there, and don't we? But it's perfect, yet it floweth fuller every day. Perfect, yet it groweth deeper all the way. And then the second verse, oh, I love this. Listen to this. Well, let's sing it. Okay? Not a surge of worry, Not a shade of care, not a blast of hurry. Not a blast. How descriptive is that? You can tell American, no American wrote that. That was written by an English person. Isn't that great? So descriptive. Let's sing it again. Hidden in the Hollow. Tragic accident in the family, and you know the story probably that the ship sank and all his daughters were drowned. He lost three daughters, and he wrote to him, and he says that peace like a river helped him to say, "It is well with my soul." What a great hymn! When you sing this hymn, just remember this man had suffered a great loss, and yet he can sing this. That's page 339, I believe. Assurance control, Christ has regarded my helpless state and has shed his own blood for my soul. Could I have something written in? I don't know. Could you have? If you had this tragedy? Sing that.
The same
Yeah.
I'm not sure what we did there, are you? I wanted to go with this group, and I wanted to go with that group. I'm that group. We finally got together on the end, didn't we?
Yeah.
Sound like it. Well, God knew what we were doing. You were singing for that. I'm sorry. We'll do better next time.
I thought you did great.
Bill always brings things into focus for us, doesn't he? I really appreciate the way he does that. I want to read from Psalm 103 today, various verses here. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget none of his benefits. Who pardons all your iniquities, who heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit, who crowns you with loving kindness and compassion, who satisfies your years with good things so that your youth is renewed like the eagle. The Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in loving kindness. He will not always strive with us, nor will he keep his anger forever. He has not dealt with us according to our sins, nor rewarded us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his loving kindness toward those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. This verse I love. Just as a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him, for he himself knows our frame. He is mindful that we are but dust. And then it goes on at the end to say that the loving kindness of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting on those who fear him. Wow. Isn't that great? I want to mention two prayer requests. Beverly Smith asked us to pray for their neighbors, Robbie and Beverly Parks, a young couple, about 50-ish, and the husband has found out that he has liver cancer, pretty progressed. And Beverly Parks may come to our class in the coming weeks. So let's keep Robbie and Beverly Parks on our prayer list, okay? And also, Ed was sharing with me this morning about sharing with a man that doesn't believe in God at all. And, of course, we all know how hard that is to make inroads with someone like that. He had some good angles. We don't even know the man's name, but he sees him regularly at a place where he goes for breakfast. So let's just pray the Lord will open his heart and begin to remove the blinders from his eyes so he'll come to Christ, okay? Our loving Heavenly Father, we acknowledge you as the awesome God, Lord. You alone are God, and as it says, from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. And Father, we think about the psalmist says, who am I that you should take notice of me? And yet you do. And Father, you continue to shepherd us, to provide for us, to encourage us, use us, to forgive us, to cleanse us, and so many other things, Lord. And we are so grateful to you for that. Lord, we do want to pray this morning for Jim and Beverly's neighbors, Robbie and Beverly Parks. Lord, it's a devastating thing to be given a diagnosis like that, and we do just ask that you might show mercy on this family, Lord, and that you as the great physician would reach into the deepest parts of his body and bring healing, Lord. Use this in their lives as a time to draw them closer to you. Lord, help us to know how we can be a part of this. We pray that Beverly Parks will feel the freedom to come and worship with us, study with us, and worship with us, and that you would use our church family in a way to encourage them. Lord, we pray for this man that Ed shared with this morning. We were all there at one point, Lord, lost, and someone cared enough to speak a word. It may have been one person that you used, or it may have been many, but Lord, seeds have been planted today with this man, and I just ask that you would, your Holy Spirit would cause him to ponder the questions that Ed asked him, and that you will create a stirring in his heart a hunger to know you, and that you would remove the blinders from his eyes, the veil from his heart, so that he can come to Jesus Christ. And Lord, even though we don't know his name, would you put that person on our mind and help us just to pray for him throughout the week. Lord, we give you this time. We ask that you would make the soil of our heart fertile as Jim shares the word with us. And Father, we just love you and recommit our lives to you for the coming week. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Well, we finished Mark last week, and for the next 2 weeks, I'm going to do something a little different. The babies go to heaven when they die. Over the past few months, I've had two that I can remember, and I think three members of our class that have questioned me. What does the Bible say about babies when they die? And at the time, I didn't really have anything off the top of my head to say, so I've been studying it for a while and came up with two lessons that I'm going to share with you. This week will be about the Old Testament. All right? Next week, we'll do the New Testament verses. And I was quite surprised when I studied it, what the Bible did say. My mother lost a baby. I didn't learn about it until just a few years ago. She never told me about it. Where did that baby go? And I think I have a brother or a sister that I haven't met. Maybe it's some of you are that way too. I also have to think, living in the United States of America since abortion has been legalized, we've seen 55 million little babies' lives taken in our recent history. 55 million. Who would they have been? What would they have done? Where'd they go? And so this is not an intellectual exercise for me. I feel deeply about it. And I believe, and after my study, I can say confidently that the Lord does too. You also have to think about such things as traffic accidents with little children, war, natural disasters, where the innocent and the unprotected and the weak oftentimes are the first to lose their lives. And where do they go? Can we say with any assurance that the Scriptures address this issue? And so I'm going to look at it with you over the next 2 weeks. And you know, when you study this, when you look at this and meditate upon it, do babies go to heaven when they die? It encompasses, and we're going to touch on so many other major truths in the Scriptures, more than just that simple little question. You have questions that are going to arise about hell, about original sin, about a concept that's called by many the age of accountability. You think about the severely retarded people that come to our world, people that are never developed intellectually to think clearly and make decisions for themselves. Predestination, salvation, judgment, and then finally just the very nature of God himself, who has created all things and placed us here. My intent is not to be some intellectual professor giving you truths that don't mean anything with this. It's not. It's for comfort. I dare say there's not a one of you that at one point or another, perhaps yourself, that have been confronted with a person that has lost a child, whether in abortion, whether through natural causes during the pregnancy or by some accident that took place right after birth. I want to read for you a verse from 2 Corinthians 1:3. This is what Paul said. He said, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and the God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our tribulations, that we may be able to comfort those who are in any trouble with the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by God. An amazing scripture there that teaches us that God is comforting us and giving us what we need in order that we can comfort others with that. People need the Lord, don't they? People need the Lord, and they need to hear from Him. And I don't have wisdom or knowledge to comfort anyone that has gone through something like this. I don't want to be silly or trite, but if I can share something from the Word of God about it, well, I'm doing a service to that person. I'm ministering to that person, and that's my intent with these two lessons. I hope you understand. Now, I've put in your handout there four predominant views among believers or people in general in the world about an answer to the question, what happens to babies when they die? Do they go to heaven? Do they go to hell? Do they cease to exist? What happens? The first one is all children who die in infancy are saved. And I'm going to let the cat out of the bag. That's where I landed after studying this. It's the most predominant view. If you look at church history, look at theologians, look at professors, this is where most of them land after a study of the Word of God. Such people as R.C. Sproul, John MacArthur, John Piper, B.B. Warfield, and Charles Spurgeon all came to this position after studying the Scriptures. The second one is just the children of believers are saved. The children of unbelievers are not, and they don't go to heaven. This is held by a very small minority of believers, very small minority, I might say. Mostly it's in the Calvinistic Reformed tradition, yet even most of those people don't believe in this one. It's too extreme and too unjust to even think about. There is a third position that we just can't know. There's no answer. It's up to us just to think whatever we want to think. And I want to tell you, that is untenable. That is not possible with a serious study of the Word of God. There are answers in the Word of God. And then finally, the fourth one, unbaptized infants are not saved, while baptized infants are or may be. Well, you know, as Baptists, we don't baptize infants, correct? We will have dedication services for them, but it is with no intention of saying that they are being baptized. However, many Protestant denominations do. The Roman Catholic Church does as well. This is something that I believe is incorrect, and you can't find in the Scriptures where infants are saved. You find adult believers baptism in the New Testament. And when I say adult, let me correct that and say age of accountability, because many children, 5 years old, are convicted of their sin. They reach that age when they hear the gospel and they know they've committed the sin and they want Jesus to come in their heart and forgive their sin. So that position I find unreasonable, and I'm not going to go there. Now, let me just say, before we get into the Scriptures, I believe that you can be confident about your position that babies go to heaven when they die. I do. I don't believe we have been left in the dark by the Lord. When I told Beverly what I was going to teach the next 2 weeks, she came right back and said, well, you better get it right, because they go to heaven. Now, Beverly's worked in Child Evangelism Fellowship for 30 years, so she's squared away on this. And I hope I get it right, darling. So, but I say again, you can be confident. There is an answer from the Lord about babies. And we're going to look at those. You're going to probably need your Bibles this morning, because I didn't have room to put all the scriptures into your handout like I normally do. On the back of the back of your handout, there's a list of scriptures. And if you want, during the week that comes, to look at those scriptures on your own, I would encourage you to do so, because that's a list of what I'm going to talk about this morning. Number one, infants belong to God in a special way. I'm just saying. The Bible teaches that infants belong to God in a special and particular way. And I'm going to reference Ezekiel 16:21 there, where the scripture says, "You have slaughtered my children," and my children, hear that? Did you hear me? "You have slaughtered my children and sacrificed them to idols." This passage is a passage where the people in Jerusalem, pagan people, had taken their infants and offered them up to the idol Molech, who was a god that wanted to sacrifice the children to him. An idol. And God here, when he's addressing this, says, "You have slaughtered my children." They're mine. Now, I think that's significant. And let me say to you, let me just clarify this before I get too deep in this and get in trouble. There is no verse in the Bible that says, "Verily I say unto you that all babies go to heaven." Neither is there a verse in the Bible that says, "Verily I say unto you that all babies go to hell." It's not there. You have to look at a number of scriptures, and it's like drugs. The Bible does not reference drugs, but there's a lot of scripture that applies to taking drugs, right? We're going to be looking at a lot of scripture from the Word of God, and there's just subtle little clues as we go through them that when we add them all up together, you're going to come to a position, I believe, that infants go to heaven. Number two, God describes children as having no knowledge of good and evil. Little children. Deuteronomy 1:39, the Bible says, "And the little ones that you said would be taken captive, your children who do not yet know good from bad, they will enter the land." Now this is the story. Joshua and Caleb had gone in there and spied out the land. They came back, said, and the other 10 that went with them said, "Oh, these people are too great for us. We can't go in there." Joshua and Caleb said, "Yes, we can." God judged the unfaithfulness of those 10 and honored Joshua and Caleb. But what he did was, he said, "You people," and there were over a million of them out there in the wilderness, "are going to wander in the wilderness for 40 more years. Why? Until all of you adults that don't believe me die. But all these children that are here looking at me today, they're going to go in." Deuteronomy 1:39 is addressing that, but take note that he says there is a possibility for little children to not know good from bad. They don't. Now we're talking little children here, right? We're not talking older. I've got some grandchildren. They know the difference between good and bad. The little ones don't. And God recognizes that. Number three, God refers to children as being unable to discern the difference between right and wrong. Little ones now. Jonah 4:11. We studied Jonah not too long ago. And Jonah 4:11, I remember when we were doing our lesson, I did not address this, but it's a curious verse that when you read it, it sounds like God's talking about everybody that lived in Nineveh. Let me read it to you. "Should not I have great concern for the great city of Nineveh, in which there are more than 120,000 people who cannot tell their right hand from their left, and also many animals?" Now, when I read that, I just assume from that that the population of Nineveh was 120,000 people. And I was surprised when we studied Jonah that many Old Testament commentators don't believe that. They believe that 120,000 he's talking about there are the little children. Because the demographics of Nineveh and the size of it, which they've uncovered and exposed, there were upwards of 500,000 or 600,000 people in that city when Jonah was there. Yet God says here, there's 120,000 of them there that can't tell their right hand from their left. And those scholars that I studied believe that God was talking there about the little children of Nineveh. I was surprised. But once again, it's just a glimmer of truth that God says that little ones can be in an age where they don't know the difference between good and bad. All right? So we're sort of, you see what we're doing? God is sort of laying out truth by truth by truth about these little ones. Just a little bit here and a little bit there. Children are born with a sin nature. The stain of Adam. We're all born with it. All mankind is born with original sin, if you will. I believe God recognizes that. I believe it's true. But there's a difference between the sin of adults and the sin of little children. And I believe the scriptures, as we go through these, are going to point that out. Adults are able to know what the truth is, and they sin anyway. They willfully sin. They hear the light, they hear the teaching of the scriptures, they hear the law of God in the Old Testament, yet they go on and sin anyway. Children are not like that. Little children are unable to discern and learn from the teaching of the law and the covenants of the Old Testament and make a rational decision for what's right or wrong. Let's look at the book of Jeremiah. Jeremiah the prophet, 19:4. For they have forsaken me and made this place of foreign gods. They burned incense in it to gods that neither they nor their ancestors nor the kings of Judah ever knew. And they filled this place with the blood of the innocents. Innocents. God is referring to children in pagan families who have been murdered as innocent. Now, this doesn't mean they weren't born with a sin nature. But it means they have a moral innocence. God does not throw around the term innocent willy-nilly. If you've read your Bible, you know that that is not something that God throws out casually. Yet he's saying these little children of these families that were living in Jerusalem worshiping these idols, they offered them up to Molech, and God said, they're innocent. They're innocent. That's important. There's another little stone in the wall we're building here. Number six, I'm going to reference back to Deuteronomy 1:39 again. God did not punish the whole nation of Israel for their disobedience in the wilderness. I've already told you that. But he only took the lives of those that were of fighting age or older. 40 years they marched in the wilderness till all those people died. God made a difference between adult sinners and innocent little children there. And I think it's important to remember that. Number seven, babies will not be punished in hell for the sin of their parents. I don't know anybody better than Ezekiel, but Moses is pretty good too to address this. You've got a lost man with a lost wife, and they raise their children to be lost, and they sin, those two parents, every day and every day and every day. Their death does not create the death of their children in hell. Deuteronomy 24:16. Parents are not to be put to death for their children, nor children put to death for their parents. Each will die for their own sin. I guess that can go either way, can't it? My son is not going to be killed because of my sin. Likewise, we can turn that around, can't we? But it's important here that God is making a distinction between the fact that as adults, when we sin, we're going to die. Yet God is going to stay his hand. He's not going to kill the whole family, right? He's not going to take the lives of the children because of the sins of the parents. Now that's Moses talking in the book of Deuteronomy. We know there's consequences for sin. We understand that. The wages of sin is death. Right? Yet, God is putting a line of demarcation down to say, I'm not going to extend that punishment for those sins to the children of the man that did it, or the woman that did it. Ezekiel 18:20. The one who sins is the one who will die. The child will not share the guilt of the parent, nor will the parent share the guilt of the child. You know, that's a blessing, isn't it? That sword cuts both ways, doesn't it? Right? There's some godly parents that have got children that make your hair stand on end, and vice versa. Right? But God is fair. God is just. He looks at the individual, and he judges the sin in the individual, whether it be the parents or whether it be the child. The righteousness of the righteous will be credited to them, and the wickedness of the wicked will be charged against them. So what God's saying here is that God does not execute death, the second death, on a person because of his parents' sin. So we're talking about children here. God does not judge and kill the children because of what their mom and dad might have done. Now, those are just, I consider those important, what we've looked at to this point. But from here on, I think these are the more weighty scripture references in talking about this fact. The children go to heaven when they die. We're going to start with 1 Kings 14:13. When God's prophet told King Jeroboam that his entire family line was going to be killed. This passage in 1 Corinthians 14, which you'll need to read the whole chapter to get the drift of it, basically said that God judged Jeroboam for his sin, and he's removing him from office for his sin. And it says in verse 13, all Israel will mourn for him and bury him. He's talking about his infant son. He is the only one belonging to Jeroboam who will be buried. The whole family, the rest of the family, no burial. Because he is the only one in the house of Jeroboam in whom the Lord, the God of Israel, has found anything good. Now that's an infant we're talking about there. Do you understand? And God is looking at the family of Jeroboam, whom he has already judged, and said they're all going to die an ignoble death and that they will not be buried, which was a huge shame to those people. Yet, God pulls it back and said there's a little baby in there, a male child, and I've looked at him and I've found something good in him. God's not going to do that to the baby. Now this is a baby that you would say is before the age of accountability. He's an infant. Yet God sees good when he looks at him. I want you to notice that here in 1 Kings 14:13, And in Jeremiah, the verse that you've got a reference to there, that both times, both of those places in the Bible, God uses positive moral categories for infants. Innocent, and good. That's giving you a little window to know, what does God think about babies? What does God think about little ones? And they can be innocent, and they can be good. I'm saying that because in the Calvinistic tradition, they would say, well, you know, they're born in original sin, and unless God has elected them to salvation, they're going to hell, these infants, these babies. I can't fathom that, neither can I find it in the Scriptures. I can't find any condemnation of babies anywhere in the Bible like that. Now let's talk about Job. Job was a righteous man, and he suffered a lot. And surprisingly, you know, Job's the oldest book in the Bible? A lot of people think Genesis is. It's not. Job's the oldest book in the Bible because of many clues that we've got there, but I won't go into that today. But Job understood that there is an afterlife. There's a heaven, if you will. Way back there, way back before Genesis and Exodus. Job 19:25, I love it. I know that my Redeemer lives, and in the end, he will stand on the earth. God, that makes my skin crawl. I mean, this was thousands of years B.C. And the Father had spoke to him and told him, I'm coming, and I'm going to stand on the earth, and you are going to see me with your eyes. That's wonderful, wonderful revelation. He goes on, even after my skin is destroyed, I will see God in my flesh. I will look at him myself, and my eyes will look at him, and not as I look at a stranger. How my heart yearns within me. Oh boy. Wonderful revelation God gave Job way back there. However, you probably already know this, but Job, several times, wished that he had died as a baby. His suffering was so great. Thank you for this cup, God. That helps. I appreciate you. Pain, suffering, can be so bad that it overwhelms people. And Job's suffering and the loss of all that he had, his health, his children, his wealth, it just all piled up on him. And let me read for you Job 3:11. Why did I not perish at birth and die as I came out of the womb? Why were there knees to receive me and breasts that I might be nursed? For now I would be lying down in peace. I would be asleep and at rest with kings and rulers of the earth who build for themselves places now lying in ruins, with princes who had gold, who fill their houses with silver. You understand what he's saying there? He's talking about an afterlife, right? He's assuming had he died as a baby in birth, that he would have gone to another place where there were kings and princes, and that, most importantly, he would be at rest. That there was no cessation of life. He would not have ceased to exist. He was hurting so bad, he was asking the Father, why can't I go like that? Why could that not have been me? It would have been better than what I'm suffering here on this earth. Job 3, verse 16 through 19 is a passage about the fate of infants. Why was I not hidden away in the ground like a stillborn child, like an infant who never saw the light of day? There the wicked cease from turmoil, and there the weary are laid to rest. Captives also enjoy their ease, and they no longer hear the slave driver's shout. The small and the great, they're there. And the slaves are freed from their owners. You know, sometimes you hear somebody say, well, those folks back in the Old Testament didn't know anything about heaven. They didn't believe in all that. Job understood a lot about heaven. Now, granted, there's revelation in the New Testament they didn't have, but I think that's pretty clear in his time of suffering that he understood that a baby that dies stillborn goes to a place of rest, and they're alive, and they're not going through all the oppression and the sin of this life. It seems pretty clear to me when I read that passage. Would you agree with me? What I just read is not describing hell. Does that sound like hell? Not at all. I think Job would agree with the statement that all infants that die or who are stillborn go to a place of rest, where there are kings and rich and poor and afflicted, and they're all free. No more slave drivers. No more bosses telling them what to do. They're in a place of rest. It's there. Now, let's look at Solomon. King Solomon back there. Ecclesiastes 6:3. He talks about in this passage a father and an infant son, infant baby boy. All right? He's still going to talk about both of them here. And I want you to notice what he says about the infant. A man may have 100 children and live many years, yet no matter how long he lives, if he cannot enjoy his prosperity and does not receive proper burial, once again, that's very important, I say that a stillborn child is better off than he is. It comes without meaning, it departs in darkness, and in darkness its name is shrouded. He's talking about the baby. Though it never saw the sun or knew anything, it has more rest than does that man, his father. You see? Once again, we're just getting glimmers of revelation here, right? We're just getting bit by bit by bit. But Solomon's understanding was that father, without a proper burial, was in a bad way. Yet, that stillborn child was going to be alive and in a place of rest. You would call it heaven. King David. This is probably, I would have to say in the Old Testament, this passage is probably the most clear about what happens to babies when they die. Let's look at it. 2 Samuel 12:23. You know the story? This is the story. David and Bathsheba were having a baby. The baby got sick and was sick for a while, apparently, a number of days. And because he was sick, David prostrated himself in the temple praying for this baby's life, for healing. Okay, that's the setting. And it says that he was grieving so much that he wouldn't eat or drink or bathe. He was crying out to God to please deliver this little baby that Bathsheba and I have. Well, while he was praying one day, he noticed his servants over there in the doorway kind of whispering among themselves, and he deduced that the little baby had died. And so he had a conversation with them, and they confirmed, yes, that little baby boy has died. Well, David got up and cleaned himself, ordered food and water, dressed himself cleanly, and was ready to go on with his life. And he said this: "Now that he is dead, why should I go on fasting? Can I bring him back again? I will go to him, but he will not return to me. That's revelation in the Old Testament, friends. David understood there was a heaven. He understood there was life after death. He understood that this infant boy had gone to the good place. And he was going there too. Do you think David didn't think he was going to the good place? He did. He was the man after God's own heart. And yet here he tells you, I understand that that little boy baby has died and he's with the Father now, and I'm going to go there too someday. And so until that comes, I'm going to get up and clean up, have something to eat, and I'm going to work. I'm going back to work as the King of Israel. I think that's a very helpful passage. I mentioned the age of accountability. Have y'all heard that? Have you heard somebody say that? You know, it's this concept we have that at some age, and it's different for every boy and girl. It is. Their children are different. Did y'all know that? Did y'all know every one of them is different? Did you find that out? Okay. Boy, they are. Same mama, same daddy, but night and day. All right. Age of accountability. Probably the clearest place in the Bible that talks about the age of accountability is Isaiah 7:16. Isaiah says, in prophecy, "For before the boy knows enough to reject the wrong and choose the right, the land of the two kings that you dread will be laid waste." And we're not going to be concerned about those two kings. Just with the point in the first part of that verse that Isaiah says that boys, and we can also say girls, can be of an age where they don't know how to reject the wrong and choose the right. That's what some theologians have called the age of accountability. I told you at the beginning, there's many other doctrines that this study opens up questions about: election, predestination, judgment, hell, the nature of God, all sorts of things just come up when we look at things like this. But I've come to believe, or I've solidified my position through this study with the fact that God elects infants who are going to die prematurely, all of them. Now, I can't give you one verse, but Ephesians 1:4. You know this verse. It says that we are chosen in Him before the foundation of the world. Who's we? Yeah, it's those that have come to Christ. We were chosen in Him before the foundation of the world. Now, I got saved in 1973, and I accepted Christ as my personal Savior, but I know that He chose me before the creation of this world. You know, I just sort of came along after the fact when He called me and I accepted Him and repented of my sin, but He chose me first. That's what election's all about. And it said it happened before He ever created the world, the universe. Isn't that amazing? Long before this world existed, He knew you, and He chose you to be in Him. That's great truth, friends. Well, I just want to throw out the possibility that he chose and elected all babies. He knew the ones that were going to die, and He chose them in Him. They're a part of His family. And just because they can't make a decision for Jesus Christ doesn't mean that He can not make a decision for them. That's what I believe. You can disagree with me if you choose. But this This concept of the death of infants requires us to look seriously at so many passages of Scripture. And when you think about the nature of God, it's what leads me to believe He's chosen them all. Spurgeon, you've heard of Spurgeon, the great preacher back in the 1800s in London. He said one time, this is his quote, "It is not that God chooses someone to salvation because they're going to die in infancy. Rather, He has ordained that only those who have been chosen for salvation will be allowed to die in infancy." Okay. You want me to read that again? Okay. "It is not that God chooses someone to salvation because they're going to die in infancy. Rather, He has ordained that only those who have been chosen for salvation will be allowed to die in infancy." All right? I don't know. It's an interesting thought. Perhaps it's helpful. Many people ask, what will my little girl or little boy be like in heaven? When I get there, what will they be like? Well, I have to tell you, the Scriptures do not address that fact. Some people believe they remain as infants until they're reunited with their parents, and then they grow. It's not in the Bible. Some people believe they are transformed into adults when they get to heaven, when they die in infancy. It's not in the Bible. We don't know. There's no proof for any position on that, so I'm not going to go there. I do want to read for you J. Vernon McGee's idea. Y'all know J. Vernon McGee? Remember him? I believe, a Texas boy, by the way, right?
Right.
Yeah, he was a preacher out in West Texas, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
"I believe with all my heart that God will raise the little ones such that the mother's arms that have ached for them will have the opportunity of holding them. The father's hand, which never held the little hand, will be given the privilege." And he says there's no biblical proof for this one way or the other. We don't know. This I know. If you have lost a child in infancy and you want to see them again, you must be born again. I believe God takes them all to heaven. And it is vitally important that if you want to see them, that you must be born again, so that you know that you are going to heaven as well. That's the best thing you can do for your family. Acts 16:31 tells us, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will be saved." Romans tells us, "For whosoever will call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." Those people are going to be reunited in heaven with children, boys or girls, that they've lost. You know, as I said, I hope I said it, there's not a verse that says all babies go to heaven. There's not a verse that says all babies go to hell. And the best, and I think the most honest approach is to look at all the Scriptures. Look at all of them. There might be a couple of these this morning I've shared that you think, "No, that's baloney." Well, throw those out. Just look at all of them together and form your own opinion in your own mind. It does seem that, I do, in surveying all the Scriptures in the Old Testament, and next week we'll look at the New, it does say to me to imply that they are going to heaven. God is just. God is just. He does all things well. He's not unjust. Never has been, never will. That's the character of God that is so important. It appears in His justice that he allows these little ones to go to heaven. They have never reached an age to reject the Lord Jesus Christ and his sacrifice for sin. What happens to people like that? God is holy, he's righteous, and he's just, and whatever God chooses to do with babies, it's going to be the best thing for him. I believe that. I believe that he loves them with a perfect love. He loves them even more than the mamas and daddies that have lost them. And I think it behooves us, knowing him, to trust him. Now, we're going to look next week at the New Testament. It's very good, by the way. There's some good verses in the New Testament on the subject. But I think we'll kind of bring it home to roost. So, if you want, study those scriptures this week, look at them, and next week I'll give you some more, and we'll look at those. All right. God bless you all.